Martha Sophia Laakso Christie was born October 1, 1907, at Winlock, Washington. She was the fifth of seven children of Carl Victor and Mary Familia Laakso, immigrants from Kalvia, Finland.
My father came over when he was about 17 years old, all by himself. I think he knew somebody in Astoria. So he went directly to Astoria, and that's where he met my mother. I don't know exactly how they met, but someone thought they were met in church, and was having the name of L-A-K. She was L-A-K-S-O and Dad was L-A-A-K-S-O. Really didn't know English at all then, but he learned English by himself and read newspapers and translated the newspapers into Finnish so he knew what it was all about. So he was really a terrific father.
Her older brothers were Elmer, Archie, and Eino. Her older sister was Mary Esther, her younger sister Ellen Ida, and her baby brother Paul Victor. In 1911, Martha's mother died of pneumonia. Although she doesn't remember her, Martha was told that she tried to crawl into her mother's casket before it was taken to the cemetery.
My earliest memory, of course, was when my mother passed away. And my father called all of us around the bed at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we had to say a prayer for Mother as she had gone to heaven. And she had been ill, died of pneumonia. It was a very sad day. After a few days, they brought my mother to the farm, and had her body in the casket in the living room. And then I remember I tried to climb into the casket, and I got a spanking for that. And I wanted to sleep with Mama, and they wouldn't let me get near her. And they wouldn't allow me to go to the funeral service. And I, of course, cried very hard.
The death drew an already close family even closer. And Martha bonded especially with her sisters, Esther, 2 years older, and Ellen, 2 years younger. As youngsters, the three girls slept in the same bed and remained best friends all their lives.
Did you share a bedroom with someone?
Ellen, Esther, and I all slept together in one bed. Mm. So, and they always made me sleep in the middle. In the summer, in the winter, they took turns sleeping in the middle.
How did that come about?
Well, because I was an easy mark, and
you let them push you around.
I let them push me around. I sure did.
Yes, but. Sleeping in the same bed, though, must have been one of the reasons you were all so close.
Oh, we were all so close. And I just loved both of them so much. And I tagged them around them every place they wanted. I wanted to follow them. So, especially Esther, because yeah. Ellen was younger. But she was always there, too.
The family suffered further grief when the eldest child, Elmer, at age 12, was sent alone by bus to Astoria for mastoid surgery for his persistent earaches.
I remember Elmer was coming home from school carrying his lunch bucket, and he was crying. He said, "I have an earache," and I was more interested in his lunch bill than I was about him being so sick. Dad called Dr. Grenlin in Astoria and told him that Elmer was very ill, so he said, "Put him on the train, and I'll meet him in Astoria." And so he went to Astoria by himself. Dad couldn't leave us because mother was gone by then, and there were seven of us children at home, no one to take care of us, so he couldn't go with him. But he put him on the train, and he never saw his son again. It was very heartbreaking to him, and he couldn't get over that at all.
His heartbroken father wrote the relatives in Finland that Elmer didn't survive the operation and never returned.
My earliest remembrance is about picking cherries and picking pears and potatoes in the field, planting potatoes. I remember I was holding a huge potato in front of me because I had a big tear in my dress, and you could still see a little tiny tear in my dress. But I enjoyed it. We had a great time living on the farm.
A housekeeper was hired to help care for the bereft family. The widowed Hilja Leppilato had a young son, Arvid, who grew up with the Laakso brothers and sisters. Hilja chose Martha to be the inside girl, and although few kind words from the busy housekeeper could be spared to encourage her, Martha learned early to keep order, to cook, and to clean.
Hilja was a wonderful cook, and she was a good housekeeper. She made me scrub the kitchen floors and the bathroom floors every day. They had to be perfectly clean. And
like painted wood floors?
No, we had linoleum.
Oh, you had linoleum.
But we had to have that perfectly clean every day.
I had freckles all over my face, and I had straight hair, red, bright copper color hair.
Yeah.
And I asked Hilda one time, she would always dress Ellen up beautifully. She'd buy dresses for her from Montgomery Ward. So one day I said, why can't I have pretty dresses like Ellen? Oh, you're too ugly. It doesn't do any good to fix you up.
That was Hilda's way. Huh?
That was Hilda. She never liked me. She said I was too ugly. She said,
oh my goodness.
Didn't do any good to fix
me. Nobody needs to hear that.
No. So it wasn't very easy growing up with that. And it stays with you the rest of your life.
Sure. And it must have made it hard for you to...
Never get over that.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway...
Even though the rest of your family knows what a wonderful person you are.
Oh, no. I don't think I've turned out so good. But Hilja...
A lot of people would disagree with that.
We had to study every night. That's one thing Hilja made us do. So she was good in some ways, but mean in another. She didn't show us much love.
No.
Which I missed.
Without a mother, sure.
Growing up. No, with no mother at all. But Dad was always very kind. He was especially fond of Ellen, because she made up to him so much. And she'd always sit on his lap and say, do you have a nickel for me, Daddy? Would say it in Finn. Do you have a nickel for me? And he said, well, I'll have it. It's 2 pennies. Could I have the 2 pennies, Daddy? She'd always get it.
He had a soft spot, huh?
Yeah, he had a soft spot for her. She was a beautiful little child. We're good looking. Very, very good looking. And here me with the red hair, straight as a stick, freckles all over my face. So that's why Hilja called me and told me that I was ugly.
I just remember you always made me feel okay about having freckles.
Oh, is that so?
And red
you
hair.
You had freckles too, didn't you?
Sure, lots of them.
Yeah.
She also learned at an early age to be a helper to anyone in need who crossed her path. Martha was educated in the Grand River and Winlock schools and liked to tell stories of how she was asked to help the younger students in the one-room schoolhouse. Years later, she always laughed helplessly when she spoke of the lisping first grader she tutored in reading, who recited, "Here, titty, titty, here, titty, titty, turn, titty, titty, turn."
I remember the first day I went to school, I did not know any English at all, but we had a wonderful first grade teacher by the name of Clara Barton. She helped me learn English. I learned phonics and then learn English. And she, but I was so bashful and so frightened the first day I went to school. And then she picked me up and held me in her lap and made me feel like, almost like she was a mother. I was 6 years old before I learned English. Spoke Finnish entirely.
Martha graduated from high school in 1926 and went on to Bellingham Normal School, now Western Washington College of Education, where she said she survived by eating oatmeal 3 times a day. She wasn't happy at school and, with financial pressures on the family, dropped out. She later confessed, "I was not a good learner." She credited her brother Eino with helping her with difficult subjects.
I had wonderful teachers when I was in the grade school, but when I got up to about 6th or 7th grade, then the teachers didn't want to bother teaching me because I was the only one in the class. So I had to listen to what the upperclassmen read, what they said, and the teacher told me, "Well, you can learn from them. Just listen to what they're saying." Well, I didn't have any really, they didn't teach me at all.
She returned to Winlock to work as a typist and bookkeeper in her father's Standard hatchery. At home in Winlock one weekend in June 1929, as Martha prepared preserves of strawberry jam on the wood-stoked stove, a fire broke out in the chimney and destroyed the family home. Convinced that she was somehow at fault, this disaster haunted her for many dreams.
Paul built a fire in the kitchen stove, and he put a huge pitch, almost a log, in the fire in the stove, which heated up the chimney to a point where it caught the papers in Alex, our hired man's bedroom next to the chimney, and started the fire.
In 1932, Martha's father married Anna Workala, a widow with 6 growing children. Richard, Samuel, Paul, Helen, Lillian, and Marion. Of this union, Martha said her father told her, "Someday, Martha, these children will be a blessing to you."
Dad took Esther and I over to see her in Kent. And while we were there, sitting in the living room, Sam Workala and Paul Workala were outside, and they were giggling like everything. They'd throw rocks through the window, open window, at us in the living room. And then they'd giggle and hide under the bin.
What did you think?
I mean, hide under the house.
What did you think about that behavior?
Well, we knew they were having fun.
Yeah.
We thought, well, they were little devils.
Do you remember your father and Anna? Courtship, their
well,
courtship.
Dad really liked her very much, and he wanted to bring her to Winlock to see what the family was like, and decided while he was there that they wanted to get married.
Oh.
And so they moved everything from Kent to Winlock.
This happened all of a sudden?
All of a sudden, mm-hmm. Yes. So
you remember the wedding?
We just had a minister come to the house, and they were married in the house.
And suddenly you had to find room for all these Workala children.
Well, we had a 13-room house, so there was room for all the kids.
Uh-huh.
And they were so thrilled to be there. And they would brag about my father being a director of the Washington Kuwaka. They told everybody what a wonderful dad they had. So, and my father would take the children to the swimming pool, which was about 4 or 5 miles out of Windlock, drive them over there almost every day swimming. And he had an old-fashioned bathing suit on, and the other kids would all make fun of him with his old-fashioned bathing suit. But Helen and Marion said, yeah, but our dad takes us swimming. Your dad doesn't take us swimming. So
they stuck up for him.
They stuck up for him, even though he had an old-fashioned bathing suit on.
What was it like growing up in a family of 13 kids?
Well, at first it was very hard for me, and I cried for a few days. And Vern Zander and his girlfriend, Olga Jacobson, took me for a ride in their car just to get me away from there for a while. But they said, well, I think you're going to like them after they get a little older. And I knew that I would. And Dad kept saying, well, someday they'll be a blessing to you. So, and they have been.
Have they?
They have been, every one of them have been a wonderful blessing. So, even though it was difficult at first, but it turned out great.
And then your father and stepmother had children of their own?
They had Carolyn and Carl, and then Pearl. So,
what do you remember about that?
Well, I remember when Carl was born. I remember when Carolyn was born too. We had to. I think she had one of these ladies that would come in as
a midwife.
Midwife, yes. Mm-hmm.
After her father's marriage, Martha moved to Seattle. She studied at University of Washington Broadway night schools and helped care for her married sister Esther's daughter during Esther's working hours.
And Mary Jane always called me Marner. She couldn't say Martha, so it was always Auntie Marner. So she still calls me Marner once in a while. She was the only one that called me that. But most of the people called me Mart or Marty.
Martha later was employed for 9 years at Burchard and Fiskin Steamship Line until Britain requisitioned the entire fleet of ships during World War II. She transferred to the Office of Censorship until the war ended in 1945.
Yes, the Army Department censored the mail, but we censored all the telegrams and telephone calls.
Oh. So what did you...
With the Navy Department.
Who were you? Maybe. So you censored telephone calls. How did you do that?
Well, we'd have to listen in and see if they had said anything derogatory against the country.
Really? Did they know you were listening?
No.
So do you remember listening in?
Yes, I remember listening to Lily Pons, was in Alaska, sang to her boyfriend in Hollywood, and... Oh, that was a thrill, and so I called everybody else. We all listened in to her singing, and she had a beautiful voice.
Five. She also worked for the Junior Chamber of Commerce under Irving Stimson, a man she greatly admired. Irv's wife, Annette, became one of Martha's closest friends. After Annette's untimely death, Martha remained dear friends with Irv and his second wife, and served as godmother to the Stimson children.
I got a call from this Miriam McLean. Said, would you be interested in working for a steamship company? And I said, I certainly would. I hope I could fill the bill. She said, I think you can. She said, but would you come to 1724 Exchange Building Monday morning? So I said, yes, I'd be there. So I got up to the 17th floor of the exchange building, scared to death. All these beautiful furnishings and everything. And they, she said, introduced me to Mr. Burchard. And he was a very dignified man, but a very pleasant man. And she said, I'd like you to interview Martha Laakso. She would like a job here. So he asked me a few questions, and I got the job. I thought I was in heaven when I got that job.
Martha lost to death all but one of her cherished Laakso brothers. Eino, a bachelor and a poet, served as wise advisor to all the family and helped their father in keeping the chicken hatchery operating in the difficult years of the Great Depression. He died in 1936 at the age of 34. Ahead of her time in connecting cancer with environmental causes, Martha believed Eino's illness may have been caused by a strong chemical this meticulous man used to keep the chicken houses clean. In 1941, Martha's brother Archie died in a tragic accident. A few weeks later, her beloved father died of cancer. In every way she could, Martha helped her stepmother and stepsisters and brothers, and her young half-sisters and brothers, traveling often to Winlock on weekends with packages of underwear, socks, and other necessities. In 1944, her youngest brother Paul, working in Portland shipyards, fell 100 feet from a mast and broke every bone in his body. Paul was permanently disabled, and Martha, along with her other loving obligations, became a source of emotional aid to Paul, his wife Phoebe, and their young family of five children. She had lived in rented apartments for her entire life away from Winlock, but in the 1950s, Martha took a bold step. She made a down payment on a small house on Snoqualmie Street in Seattle, took driving lessons, and bought a car. She led an active social life and for 25 years enjoyed singing in the Plymouth Congregational Church Choir. Telephoning long distance was more of a luxury then than it is today, and she wrote often to her large family. Always there was mention of some ailing neighbor or friend or elder person for whom she shopped or did errands or whose cat she fed. If there was somebody in need of help, Martha was bound to find that person. For the last 24 years of her career, Martha worked as an executive secretary and assistant purchasing agent at Kron Zellerbeck in Seattle. Many of her associates there became her close friends. Of her working life, Martha said, "I loved every job I ever had. I always found the people and the work so interesting." After she retired in 1972, she traveled to Europe, including the then Soviet Union, and to the Hawaiian Islands. On a cruise to the West Indies, she learned to snorkel. Finnish had been the language of her early childhood, and she continued to speak and write it, through letters, keeping up with the connection with her relatives across the sea. After World War II, Martha and her sisters had sent packages of scarce commodities such as sugar and coffee to their war-weary relatives. During three visits to Finland in the 1970s, she became acquainted with a number of her Finnish heritage people, many of whom later visited her at her Seattle home. A happy surprise for Martha and her sisters occurred in the 1940s when Arvid Lepolato, the son of the housekeeper who had helped raise the family, reunited with his Laakso foster sisters and surviving foster brother Paul. Arvid, or Slim as he was later known, had become a successful owner of a river transportation company and helped many of Martha's relatives get started in their own working lives. Slim and his wife and children were absorbed into this complicated tribe and over the years faithfully attended the reunions held up and down the coast to celebrate various events from marriages to retirement parties. Altogether, Carl Laakso had helped to raise 17 children. Slim's mother in her last years lived with Paul Laakso, the baby she had helped raise after his mother died, and his wife Phoebe at their home in Winlock. Hilja Lepolato Moisio is now buried in the Laakso family plot in tribute to the role this hardworking woman played in the family story. On February 21, 1981, at the age of 74, Martha married Stanton Christie in a ceremony performed by Dr. David Colwell at Plymouth Congregational Church. Stanton, who had been a college track star in his youth, introduced Martha to the world of athletics. She joined him when Stanton officiated in track and field meets, including the 1984 Los Angeles Olympics. Stanton was an active Mason, and Martha, often in formal dress, celebrated ladies' night functions at Masonic and Scottish Rite meetings. She learned to enjoy Mariner baseball games at the Seattle Kingdome and became an ardent Mariner fan, shouting herself hoarse for her team. Once the couple was caught in a torrential rainstorm on their way to a Mariners game, and Martha liked to tell the story of how another family came to the rescue and helped them dry out in the bleachers. At Martha's festive 90th birthday party, held in 1997 at the home of her stepsister and stepbrother-in-law Lillian and Ted Bartholomew in Tacoma, one younger family member after another rose to relate a story of how Martha had helped him or her during a crucial time. A nephew told of her buying him a suit for his first job. A stepbrother spoke of help with a project that would lead to his career. Nieces thanked her for making them feel special at Christmas. Each speaker had somehow thought that he or she was the only one Martha had favored, and it was a revelation to the family how widely Martha's generosity had been spread. On this occasion, Martha repeated her father's words when he took on a new family. "These children will be a blessing to you, Martha." 6 years later, at the funeral of her sister Ellen in Southern California, she rose to her full, tiny height and in a breathless but still strong voice repeated these words, "These children will be a blessing to you." Her father was right. She may be the last of her generation, but it's a generation that doesn't end. The example of her spirit lives on in all those whose lives she touched. With the help of her niece, Janice Marks, Martha, at the age of 95, flew from Seattle to her sister Ellen's funeral. Janice likes to tell the story of her Aunt Martha arriving at SeaTac without a shred of identification. Despite Janice's pleas and tears, Martha was not going to be allowed to board the flight to Southern California until finally someone in security asked the pilot if he would be comfortable flying with such a passenger. The pilot not only let her board, but announced over the loudspeaker that it was a pleasure to be flying today with Miss Martha Christie, age 95. The other passengers applauded. If there is a theme to Martha Laakso Christie's life, it is one of resilience in the face of loss. Despite the many catastrophes she endured, from the death of her mother in early childhood to devastating financial reverses in old age, her love for her family and her friends, her tradition of service to others, and her own forgiving heart always gave her strength to go on. The little red-headed girl who was told she was too homely for nice dresses and who felt she wasn't a good learner became a strong and independent career woman, as well as a source of unstinting love to her vast family and many friends. Martha was always ready to try new experiences. She was also a lot of fun. She is survived by her sisters Carolyn Coran of Berkeley, California, Pearl Russo of Lafayette, California, brother Carl Laakso of Portland, Oregon, stepsisters Helen Salinas of Sacramento, California, Lillian Bartholomew of Tacoma, Washington, Marion Steinberg of Walnut Creek, California, stepbrother Paul Werkala of Pleasant Hill, California, 24 nieces and nephews, and numerous grandnieces and grandnephews.